Hello, everybody. I am James Woodall. I am a reader and head of subject in health promotion at Leeds Beckett University. And with me today is...
Hello, everyone. I'm Jo White. I'm a senior research fellow at the University of West of England, and I also run the health promotional module on the MSc Public Health Programme. So today we're going to be talking about different models in health promotion and running you through several models and their strengths and limitations and how they can be used in practice. Jamie, do you want to say a little bit about why it's important to have these kind of models in our health promotion work?
So I think models are really important for lots of reasons. One is it provides us with a kind of framework for practice. It gives us an indication of how we do or practice health promotion. And I think models are really helpful in making explicit some of the decisions and approaches that we take in our work. I also think models have lots of limitations, and we'll maybe come to some of those in this conversation. But I think models are very helpful in offering transparency for doing health promotion and demonstrating the breadth of health promotion and what it can possibly achieve.
Right. OK, great. So I think to start off with, we're going to talk about Tannehill and Beattie's model. Is that right?
Yeah, if you just give me a second, I've just got, for those of you less familiar, I'm just going to open up a sort of slide that might just remind you of these two particular models. So you should be able to see on the left of your screen a Venn diagram, which is known as kind of Tannehill's model, broadly speaking. And on the right hand side of the screen, that's Beattie's model. So if I talk a little bit about Tannehill first, Joe, if that's OK, and just kind of talk a little bit about what this model tries to achieve. And I guess what I'm not going to do is go into mass detail and describe the models, because I think there's lots of textbooks and really helpful tutorials out there that can support you with that. But I think Tannehill's model is really important because it was one of the first health promotion models that I was really aware of that kind of tried to conceptualize what health promotion was about. And I think it's really important to place it in a historical context, because this model was developed in the mid-1980s, so around the time of the Ottawa Charter. And you can see that it groups health promotion into kind of three broad areas. One we could broadly call health education. One we could broadly call prevention of ill health or disease prevention. And the other circle or category is what we call the protection of health. So broadly speaking, things like legislation and pieces of action like that. And like any Venn diagram, these areas overlap so that you can have a combination of the three categories of education, prevention and protection. And by overlapping these spheres of activity, you create a program of activity to apply to mental health or obesity or any of those kind of health issues.
Okay, can I just ask, so would one say that it's interesting that the way they do overlap, so would the optimal activity be to ensure that you do overlap them, or would there be some activities that clearly be located in one of the different spheres?
I think that's an excellent question, Joe, and I think it's difficult to know exactly how Tannehill conceived of this model. So you'd sort of assume that the optimum intervention would be where the three spheres overlap together. So that kind of, I'm not sure what the shape is in the middle, but the bit in the middle, you would suspect would be the combination of these three types of approaches. But what that looks like in practice, I think, is very different. And I think that's one of the issues about this model is, you know, what does those overlapping spheres look like in reality?
Mm-hmm. And I think the message is they don't have to be mutually exclusive. I suppose that by overlapping in that way,
absolutely,
they do not have to be exclusive activities and separate, distinct. But the question might be, how do you bring them together?
Absolutely. I think that's one of the strengths of the model, in that it does allow for that overlap. And, you know, it kind of clearly says that, you know, these things, you know, cannot be seen as being in isolation. But I think what's also quite interesting about this model is the semantics that's used, so the words that are used. So you have to think that health promotion was very much at its infancy at this point in time. So you can see there, you know, if we look back at it now, we might say that it's quite a limited model in that it doesn't really explicitly address things like well-being or sustainability or some of those things that we might now associate with health promotion and social determinants. But nonetheless, it is, in my opinion, one of the first attempts to really solidify what health promotion does and how practitioners should be conducting their work.
Great. Okay. And is it being used a lot? I know it will be referred to in the textbooks, but from your knowledge, is it being used by practitioners?
Again, I think that's a really interesting question, Joe. And, you know, I think a model like this was really helpful for shaping debate rather than for shaping practice. So I think it was a really useful kind of point for academics, scholars, those people who are interested in health promotion, to really debate what the discipline was and what the kind of activities should comprise of. So I'm not sure that it's particularly well used in practice. I could be wrong, but I think what it certainly did offer was an opportunity for debate and dialogue, and I think it did push the agenda forward, which is, again, we'll talk about BT, and I think BT's model could be seen as the sort of next generation of ideas around health promotion.
Okay, so going from the conceptualization from Tannehill, should we move on to BT now then?
Yeah, so BT's model came sort of 5 or 6 years after Tannehill. So BT's model, if you look at the citation, it's 1991. And again, it looks very different in just visually, doesn't it? It's a very different approach to thinking about health promotion. But I think in those kind of 5 or 6 years between Tannehill's model and BT's model, much had been discussed. Lots of policy had been developed in regard to health promotion, both nationally and internationally. And I think you see a more sophisticated viewpoint of health promotion. And in essence, it's built upon two axes. So the Y axis, which is the vertical axis, which looks at whether the intervention in health promotion is negotiated with individuals and communities, or whether it's more authoritative and what we might kind of call top down. Mm-hmm. And then across the kind of the X axis or the horizontal axis, you've got again a kind of more collective approach to thinking about how we address sort of population health versus do we look at more individually focused interventions and approaches. And by putting those two kind of axes together, you come up with four quadrants. And again, unlike sort of Tannehill's model, like you said, Joe, kind of the overlap is quite helpful because it kind of visually indicates that these things merge and it is not clear. And I think sometimes the criticisms of BT's model is that people see their work in the quadrants. Mm-hmm. And actually those quadrants are quite big in terms of their activities, and there could be, you know, many different variations of, let's say, legislative action. If you look at a kind of top-down collective approach to health promotion, you know, policy in health promotion can vary from huge scale, from kind of global geopolitical type action right the way down to sort of school level or settings level. So so it does move on conceptually, but again, it does have its drawbacks as well.
And also, I was just thinking, when you're saying about legislation and policy changes, sometimes that can be a response to collective action. You know, they can be connected, can't they? There can be a synergy across activities, can't there?
Absolutely. And I think you're absolutely right that, you know, ideas like community development that can link, you know, that sort of empowerment type approach can link to policy change, you know, and social action and mobilization. So that they are, again, not discrete. But I think what BT's model is very effective at is sort of dispelling the myth that health promotion is just about telling people what to do or about education or information giving. And it does begin to sort of suggest that wider policy role, the role of empowerment and mm-hmm. actually community development and sort of bottom up, top down ideas. So mm-hmm. I think for me, it's probably a very well cited model and possibly you know, quite well used in practice in sort of mapping interventions and ideas.
Yeah, and I was thinking from our students' point of view, the students that study on my module, for example, we're trying to teach them how to critically evaluate different approaches. So it's quite helpful to, I think BT has been very valuable to sort of look at that, look at an initiative and analyse it in relation to the BT model and think about strengths and weaknesses and how it could be transformed in different ways or improved in different forms of activity. So it's very valuable in that sense, isn't it, to apply sort of critical lens.
Absolutely, and it has huge versatility in that, you know, models and theories are very useful because they can be applied to lots of different contexts. I think BT's model does overlay really nicely onto a range of issues and topics, and it, you know, it does have that transferability. What I would say, I know this is something that we're both interested in Joe, is the kind of international perspective of these models, which we might talk about in another video. But you know, I do think these models were very much derived from a kind of Eurocentric idea of health promotion, because you know, in 1985 when Tannehill's model and 1990, you know, there wasn't a lot of kind of international consensus. It was very kind of Eurocentric or ideas from Canada. You know, if we go back to the Lalonde report in the 1974, and if we look at Australia, you know, these were the kind of players that were shaping the discussion and the discourse. And actually, you know, the voices of, you know, sub-Saharan African academics and professionals working in the area, as an example, I think were relatively unheard during this process.
Okay, and has that changed, would you say, or should we go on to talk about that in the
I think it's probably worth saying that I don't think it has necessarily transformed too drastically. I think there is still a strong sort of Eurocentric Canada Australian type discourse that I think does tend to there's a sort of publishing issue there as well about where these models are cited and where people get published. So I think it's quite a complex issue, but you know, I certainly would like to see moving forward, and I know we'll talk about this in another video, about a sort of new conceptualization of health promotion that perhaps has a more international dimension.
Interesting. Okay, great, thanks James. So we'll say goodbye now, and hope you enjoy this video, everybody.
Yep, thanks everyone. Thanks Joe.